pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, I'm gonna go a little bit out of order. I'm gonna take new business. Christine Carson, 1000 Old Albany Post Road. Are you doing that one, Gwen? No? She here? Anybody here for 1000 Old Albany Post Road?
No, I don't see her.
Huh?
I don't see her.
Nobody here. All right. Push it on to next month, the review for next month.
Right?
Nobody here?
Well, yeah, they would need to be advised of certain information that they need that hasn't been provided with the application. They have to fill out an area variance application. All that we were provided with, apparently, were the materials that were submitted, or some of the materials that were submitted to the planning board. They need to fill out an area variance application because that's why they were referred from the planning board to the zoning board. So we should probably advise them of that before the next scheduled meeting, and at the next scheduled meeting we'll do a review for completeness. Next hopefully they will have the area variance application at that time.
Okay. Oh, first of all, I'd like to introduce a new member, Granite Frenza. He's replacing Bill Flaherty. Bill was on a board for, what, 100 years? How long was on Bill on? A long time, right? And he was worked for the county, he worked for the town effortlessly. And he's in retirement, he certainly deserves it. But we wish you a lot of luck on the position. Okay. We're gonna be a little light tonight, okay? We got enough for a quorum, but Mr. Sestone is still on vacation, and I got a call about 4 o'clock from Paula Claire. She's got a flat tire in Syracuse. That's not the place to be with a flat tire, 4 o'clock. So. But we're going to continue with the meeting, and we're going to proceed as much as we can. Probably we'll go through the public hearing, but I'm going to postpone all votes till next month, because until we have a full board, because I think it's the only fair way to do it to both people. Okay? Because otherwise, if I do a vote, it has to be unanimous or nothing. You know, otherwise, you know, this way, it's not fair to Mr. Flavin, and it's not fair to Mr. Nice. All right, but we are going to go through with the public hearing and hopefully close it tonight. Because you guys keep sending me, these attorneys keep sending me information in the last day, you know, but not you, the other attorney back there. You know, it's just, you can't keep sending me stuff. You know, the last day, it's tough. You know, I only got so many hours in a day, and I'm not dedicated to looking at this all day long. Okay. Now, the second one we're going to do is the application for 537 East Mountain Road North. Is a variance for a carport. I guess the carport is there.
Yes, that's the Firestone application.
Correct.
Yeah, we represent Jim in this application.
Right. Let's see, we got the application. You want to tell me a little bit about it, Glenn? Or?
Well, there was a carport put up without a permit. And it was put up too close to the road. When that came to light, when the project engineer, who's my car, was up there doing some work, and he figured out that it had to be too close to the road, then we figured out that it didn't have a permit. So Mr. Firestone, who is relatively new to the area, wants to fix it. He hired a builder who said according to Mr. Firestone, I'll have him here at the public hearing, that the person who built it told him he didn't need, it wasn't a garage, it was a carport, and he didn't need a variance, he didn't need a building permit. Of course he did. And we want to correct it. We're well away from any neighbor's houses. We're not well away from the property line as we should be, but we're well away from any neighbors' houses, I understand, and we will hopefully present some stuff that indicates that the neighbors have no objection to the variance. And so we ask, if you find it complete, to schedule a public hearing. And at my request, if it could be scheduled in the November meeting, as I won't be here for the October meeting.
Okay.
I looked over, it seems complete. It just seems like a straightforward thing. You have any problems with it, Lenny?
No, I don't.
Okay, this time make a motion that this be deemed complete.
I'll make the motion.
Favor? Aye? Okay, unanimous, so it's been deemed complete by three board members.
Thank you.
And it'll be set for November 14th.
Thank you very much.
Okay. November 14th, so you have time to put out the notices to the neighbors. Linda? Okay, good. All right. We got rid of that. Next one I'm going to do is 7 Old Manitou Road. Mr. Morrison? Okay, hi, how are you? There's a public hearing on your application. And I have a couple questions. A couple of questions on it. Your original house now is what, 1,700 square feet?
That's about right, yes.
Right, and you're looking to put on another? I'm sorry? Oh, you're going to speak? I got to go over to the microphone over there. I'm sorry.
Here?
Yeah, please. Both of you go over there. So you're on film. That wasn't mine. That's mine.
I just put that.
You just put that there?
Yeah.
You sure?
Yeah.
Okay.
That's what we need both.
All right. You're right. I guess my concern is, I looked at the plans, and is that all new construction on those plans? The plans that I was given.
Only the space over the garage, and then there's also one area over the family room. Can I walk up and?
Yes, please. Because I was a little confused on it. You know what I'm trying to say? Because I know you're attaching this to the house that's there now,
yes.
Correct?
Actually, this would be a good starting point. So this footprint is the footprint of the existing house. This footprint is the addition. But then there's an area right here over the family room, which would get some additional space as well.
Okay, so you drew this in?
Yes.
Okay. Now, so show me here what exists and what's new, I guess is what I'm trying to say.
Right, so this exists.
Okay.
This is new. And then this is the new part as well.
Oh, okay, so this already exists.
That's already existing, yes.
Oh, okay, I get it, all right.
So we're taking out like a portion of the gable wall to be able, and you have to go up a few more steps to get to the height where you're above the family.
Oh, okay, so this is not all new construction.
No, the only new footprint is actually this.
The only footprint basically is this 26-foot wide square here.
Yes.
That's going onto the house.
Yes.
Okay, all right, that makes it a little more understandable. Thank you. Now, what is the variance we're looking for here? How many feet, I guess? Setback needs to be 50 feet.
My understanding is that the setback requirement is 60 feet.
Right.
And jump in if this isn't correct. And you're proposing a setback of 21 feet.
Right. The majority of the house, as you can see from the site plan, it starts at almost zero.
Right.
So even though that number in itself sounds onerous, the fact is that it's pushed as far back from the road as most of the house could be.
Right. So you're looking for a 21-foot variance from the frontage.
Depending on how you describe it, that would be the dimension that's left. So it's not.
So it's
actually, Adam would probably have a better way of saying it. Like the variance is actually for
the proposed construction will be set back 21 feet from the front yard lot line. And 60 is required.
Yes.
Okay, 50 is required, all right.
60.
60 is required, so that's a 39-foot difference.
Is it from the lot line or the center of the road?
From the front yard lot line.
Right, there was some reason that they said, or it could be from the center of the road. I guess it depends on whether it was a country road or something along those lines, but that's for you guys to decide.
Okay, so you're looking for a 39-foot variance. How many more bedrooms are you adding here? I'm just curious.
We're not actually, so the house is currently three
bedrooms. It doesn't make any difference to me what's going to happen if you go to building inspector, this is passed, he's going to send you today.
We've already been through that process. We already went to the health department and.
You've already been through that, okay.
Yeah, optimistically hoping that things would go up. So it's currently a three bedroom and it would stay a three bedroom, but obviously we're making a much larger master bedroom and putting both kids' rooms on the upper floor.
Okay.
And then undoing the one that's in the basement. the walkout basement.
In looking at this, I went over there and looked at it like that. They are pretty close to the street there, that's for sure. But the house is what? How many? Long, eight, house is 60, 70 years old, I guess?
Oh, no, 1850. So there's an 1850 part. It was part of the Manitoba Quarry.
Okay.
So there's an 1850 part, and then it's a 1970s, and then it's a 1920s.
Okay. In the existing structure, are you going to try and blend it together? Or is it, you know what I'm trying to say, as far as siding and...
Yes,
you know, we... Try to make it... It's not going to look like two different houses.
No. We're going to use the older version of the wider, thicker siding and the trim style and get rid of the 70s effect, because there's already two types of siding on it.
Right.
And go with that for everything.
Okay.
And windows, it'll be all blended as one.
Okay. You're the architect, right?
I am, yes.
Okay, Mr. Morrison, would you like to speak to the reason you're looking for this?
Well, basically, two children, 8 and 10 years old, now living in their own bedroom, a daughter, a son, and they're getting bigger, and having two adolescents wandering around the house right. of that size is going to be tight. And so we wanted to build something, and we've looked for years and years different alternatives of extending or adding or moving, or and this seems to be the most logical way to put something that's attached to the house but not too close to the road, and also to make it more rational, because at the moment there's one bedroom on the top level, one on the ground floor, and one on the basement, and which is a bad way to arrange your children. So
okay. And I read in and I looked at, according to the engineers, I guess there's no way to move that closer back far from the street. I mean, there's no way to push it further back. You can't, at the end of the house, you have there's another cottage there or something like that.
At the end of the house, there's an 8-foot wall. There's this 8-foot stone wall that runs down the property.
Right. Tall, 8-foot tall stone wall.
Yeah. Right. And so if we were to build there, you'd end up with a long, thin house.
Right.
It would probably look actually worse than this one, which is kind of compact.
Right.
And you'd have to re-engineer that wall, and you're bumping up against another structure that is further along the property than that.
Right.
And I suspect the ground slopes away quite strongly, and it's already at a 6 to 8 foot drop. So I suspect by the time this is built, you wouldn't actually notice that anything had been built. You'd go past and say, was that like it was before? Was that there?
Right, right.
And we like our house. We very intentionally want to make this part of the same farmhouse look.
Right, okay. Does anybody want to speak to this in the audience? Any neighbors or anybody? Nobody complaining? I mean nobody with a different opinion, what I'm trying to say. Are you prepared to vote on this? I'll wait for the full city next month. Okay. I'll tell you what we're going to do, Mr. Morrison. I'm going to close the public hearing, right? And what we'll do is, the whole board is not here, okay? Unfortunately, we're missing two members, okay? And the same thing would, same thing for you. If we take a vote, it has to be of three people, you know what I'm trying to say? So I'm trying to make it fair to you. This way, if there's five people here and one person against, you still got 4-3-2 or something like that. So I'm going to push you off till, if it's all right with you, okay, as far as a vote, I'm going to push you off to our next meeting, which is going to be October 17th.
Yes, that's fine. Will you have many questions at that time?
No.
Does?
I guess I should leave the public hearing open. Adam, Adam, what do you think?
That's fine in the event they have
somebody in case a neighbor another has a question. Now we'll leave it open. Okay. What I mean by that is October 17th, in case some of the not new board members, the board members are absent, they might have a question or two. Okay. Now they've been on the board for a long time, and we had ample time to go over all the thing like that, but they may have a question or two. So make it fair to them also. There won't be a lot of questions. And then we will close the public hearing and we'll take a vote then. Okay? Then you only need three. Is only three to vote against or whatever. It's more advantageous and more in your favor, to be fair. Okay?
Sure.
All right. So October 17th, it'll be 7:30, it'll be here. Okay, thank you. Okay. Next, we're going to do a public hearing. It's going to be for Mr. Flavin.
Excuse me, before you move forward, I'm Kristen Sorensen. I guess we were dismissed, and I'm just, I apologize for making you go backwards, but can you just explain why we're not able to talk
yeah, sure.
about our property?
Tonight, you mean?
Yes.
Yeah, because there's only three board members here. Okay, the full board consists of five. Okay, one person unfortunately had a car problem up in Albany, and the person isn't here. So if we were to vote on this now, okay, all three would have to say yes.
Well, if, Mr. D, just so you know, you were on for a review for completeness.
Oh, just completeness. So I get the wrong one. I was more on completeness.
Yeah,
I'm sorry.
So just what I advised the zoning secretary.
Right.
The item that you need, and then your application should be complete, is you need to ask the building department for an area variance application. You were referred from the planning board to this board for an area variance, and the board has an application specifically for area variances that was not submitted. I have no personal knowledge of what went on. I know you're a referral from the planning board, and we reviewed what has been submitted, and we had planning board materials.
If there's anything that we need, you have my number, and I didn't know that my application was incomplete. So
you would need to fill out your area variance application, and as I understand it, the next meeting is October 17.
Okay.
So you would be scheduled for your review for completeness on October 17? Your area variance application.
That to Linda?
Yes, and then she'll provide that to the board. And then, assuming that the application is complete, we would then schedule you for a public hearing in November.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Okay. No problem. I'm glad you spoke up. I unfortunately, I thought you were someone else.
No.
There's one other question.
Go ahead.
The other issue, is that the other issue was that the
you have to speak over here. I'm sorry. But just call me this thing. Is it only fair to?
There were, I guess, two issues involved. One of them was area, and the other one was the fact that the neighboring, the property that's giving us the land, the additional 40 feet, would then go from having 60 feet of frontage to having 20 feet, which is their actual driveway.
Correct.
So is there anything that we have to submit in regards to that? Is there any application that regards that?
That's all part of the area variance.
That's all part of
and definitely, confer with the building inspector. My understanding is there's road frontage that you have an insufficient amount of that's proposed, and apparently one of the lots, I guess that's donating the land, will be somewhat smaller and more non-conforming. Correct?
Yeah, that's correct. I mean, it's interesting because what we're doing is they've actually purchased 4 acres of land from us, which gives them an additional 20 feet next to their already existing driveway of 20 feet. So they have a 20-foot driveway, 20-foot piece of land with a 10-foot wide driveway. They've just bought from us, we're about to close on Friday, an additional 20 feet with a 4-acre parcel attached to that. So they're actually growing technically in size from 6 acres to 10 acres. And then as part of that deal, they're giving us back the unused, because that was an illegal subdivision originally. And so it was divided into three lots, and then the town forced them to recombine those lots, and not them, but the prior owner, into one lot. So what was originally three lots down there of 2 acres each, illegally subdivided, were forced back into 6 acres. We had bought an additional 4 acres, which we have sold to them, and now they have 10 acres and a 40-foot piece of land.
It's all kind of that's fine. I'm just saying you're seeking area variances, and you're going to need to submit an area variance application. And once we have that application, the board will certainly ask you questions to clarify exactly what you're seeking, but that's the next step.
Okay.
One second. Would both of them need an area variance? Would both him and his neighbor both need an area variance, or just him? You know?
There are two lots involved. I just to be clear, one lot is going to be somewhat smaller, the one that's donating the land, correct?
Right.
And one of the lots that you're proposing is going to have insufficient road frontage. Is that it?
Technically, it's going to go from 60 feet to 20 feet, but it's actually going to meet the code because it's going to go to an additional 20 feet next to that, which will give it the 40 feet it needs. I believe it's 40 feet.
I think at this point it's really premature to start having an extensive conversation. You need to fill out an area variance application to outline exactly, and the building inspector will tell you these are the variances that you will need. Or if you have any questions, the planning board can clarify as to why they were sent over. But you do need an area variance application, and you need to be specific as to the variances that you're going to need. So, but there's no use having an extended discussion right now because we don't even have an area variance application.
Well, just one last question. Our lot is actually growing in size. It's undersized given the current zoning, but when it was actually a billable lot, and it is still a billable lot at 2 acres.
If the building inspector does not believe that you need an area variance for that part of your application, he will advise you of that. But we need the area variance application, and the building inspector will guide you as to the variances that you need.
Okay. Good. Thank you.
Okay, welcome. Thank you. All right, next is a continuation of public hearing for 51 Indian Brook Road, Mr. Flavin. I guess I got a letter last week from Mr. Nice's attorney regarding accessory apartment.
Yes, sir.
Could you speak to that? Am I going to be able to speak to that?
Well, we did submit a letter last week, Your Honor, Mr. Chair.
Please.
Chairman D, members of the board, as you will recall, my name is Dan Richmond. I'm here on behalf of the Nice family. We learned last week that there had actually been a certificate of occupancy issued for a what appeared to us to be a dwelling unit on this site already. I understand the applicant has just submitted a letter. I haven't had an opportunity to review it in detail. I would be happy at the next meeting or if in writing to respond.
My intention is to try and close the public hearing tonight.
I appreciate that. So all I can say is, you know, what was in our letter, which was there is a certificate of occupancy, which suggests that there is already an apartment existing on the premises that as such it would be appear improper to add an additional accessory apartment. I believe to suggest that that's something the board should look into. Again, I just saw the applicant has submitted a letter this afternoon, that purports to address that issue. I would want an opportunity on behalf of our clients to have to review it and comment intelligently on it.
Okay. All right. Thank you. I got to take a minute to address the issue of the accessory apartment.
Sure.
Okay. On Sunday, yesterday, I visited both Mr. Flavin's home and Mr.
We appreciated that. Nice's I was going home. To mention that,
okay.
Mr. Chairman.
And Mr. Flavin graciously invited me inside his home. Okay. Mr. Flavin, on that addition, what he did was he extended his kitchen, put a dining room and a bedroom. There is no accessory apartment in Mr. Flavin's home. Okay?
You were there. I wasn't.
I was there, and I can tell you there is no apartment there. Is that it?
Well, we have other comments on it. Comments on the other application. Should I proceed with our comments?
Sure.
Mr. Chair and members of the board and Mr. Durrott, we have had an opportunity to review the applicant's latest submission and respectfully submit that there are still major outstanding issues that we would ask your board to attend. And one of them is, again, we appreciate that the chair made the effort to go out to the site. I understand the applicant will present to you this evening certain videos purporting to show what the lighting impact of driving on this route on the Nice family would be. It's, again, in our estimation, has no real empirical value because it is taken from their property. So I don't understand how it can purport to show what the lighting impact is on the Nice family. And in fact, as we know in our letter, Mrs. Nice did see the lighting from one of those driving tests or whatever they were calling them. And as I think the chair certainly would know when it was out at the site, much of the existing screening there is deciduous, will not be there in the winter. So whatever they're showing now, which I guess these videos were taken when there is the most foliage on the leaves, will not reflect reality in the winter. We would ask your board, again, it's particularly if you're deferring the vote for a month, I think it's something that was within its ability, to visit the site at night, visit, see through the Nice family what the lighting impact of someone driving down that road is. And I think you will see something different.
Several of the board members have visited the site, not just myself. Great. So as far as a night, everybody go there at night to see the lights, something like that, I don't think that that's required. I'm not going to ask that of board members.
Okay, then I guess in our view, Mr. Chair, respectfully, then it is an outstanding issue. We don't see how this issue has been addressed, and it's a major impact on our clients from this project. We also have continually, as our clients have raised throughout these proceedings, stormwater impacts and impacts of how your drainage from this system is going to be handled, particularly from the building, the new pervious surfaces, impervious surfaces, including the roof. We understand there's going to be a curtain drain on the other side of the property. We're wondering why there's not a curtain drain along the Nice family. And it goes in connection with the other concern we have, as we have asked, that with respect to the proposed landscaping, there should be a maintenance bond. As your code specifically establishes, your board has the authority to impose, quote, any conditions necessary to fulfill the purpose of the chapter, quote, including the posting of performance bonds and a furnishing of guarantees to ensure the completion of projects in accordance with the conditions imposed. I think that clearly gives your board the authority to first impose a bond to ensure that the landscaping it survives for three seasons, which I submit is a basic requirement that any board can impose. We would also suggest, again, if the applicant is not willing to do full stormwater study now, that there should be some kind of bonding so that, for example, 1 year, if it turns out within 1 year constructed that there is actually stormwater impacts affecting the Nice family, that there is sufficient money then to take some action, some compensatory action.
Okay. Any else?
That's it for now. I'll wait to see what their presentation is. Thank you very much,
Mr. Chair. Mr. Flayman's attorney. No, we're not done.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, members of the board, Mr. Rod. My name is Taylor Palmer. I'm with the law firm of Cuddy & Fader. Here on behalf of the applicant, Stephen Flavin. Mr. Chairman, respectfully, our formal submission was actually submitted on August 29th, following up on the correspondence from the prior public hearing held on July 25th. This additional submission was in response to the neighbor's attorney who submitted their letter regarding an accessory apartment on September 7th. We had previously addressed concerns from those neighbors, including proposed screening in the location of the driveway. And tonight I'm joined by Glenn Watson of Beatty & Watson, who will go through the revised plan set and will present before the board some additional video footage, if the board sees fit, showing vehicles driving down the driveway in that particular location to show the existing screening. As the neighbor's attorney pointed out, there is additional screening proposed in that location. So as we'll show the board, there is certainly dense vegetation there, and we understand that the board members have also visited the site. But again, we're proposing screening that's shown on the plan. Additionally, we have Mary Rice here from Beatty & Watson, who will also go through to describe what types of trees are being proposed in this location. The neighbors have presented an interest in a specific type of tree, which Mr. Flavin has work to address. There is certain concerns with walnut trees. I will not try and put that hat on today, but I will turn to Mary with respect to the impacts of a walnut tree on the roots and what could actually be affected and what types of trees should be in that location given that concern. The neighbors again presented issues regarding drainage. Mr. Watson will also present and show for the board how there is no impact in the existing conditions or the proposed conditions for the drainage. So at this time, if the board sees fit, Well, certainly, again, the letter that was prepared to the board this evening was certainly just, it's a follow-up specifically to the accessory apartment issue. We do respectfully submit, as the chairman indicated, that there is not an existing accessory apartment. Indeed, the applicant is before this board in order to request, want the first and only accessory apartment above the garage for this application. So again, the correspondence that was provided today was simply to respond to that. But again, we're doing so here at the public hearing, so there were no further comments that would need to be addressed in that. Again, it's for the board's reference and summarizes our submissions to date.
Thank you. I believe Mr. Lum, you visited the site?
Yeah, I made a site visit, and I don't know what everybody's talking about, but I did pick up a big walnut. Okay.
But were you inside Mr. Flavin's home? Did you get inside?
No, but I did walk around the outside, and I didn't see an extension. I saw a kitchen. I mean, they built a kitchen. I didn't see an extension apartment.
And for the record, there is one kitchen.
I was inside. There is only one kitchen. I saw the Mr. Flavin took me through the whole house. So.
And our letter does explain further the definitions that are in the code that explain what a housekeeping, or excuse me, what right. a dwelling unit is, and further how it that the one dwelling on right. the property is one dwelling.
You're correct.
And if I may, I'll turn it to Mr. Watson to sure. show the board the additional changes to the plans and the video if the board sees fit.
I got a question.
Yes, Mr.
What is this big deal about a walnut?
I will not put that hat on. I will turn it to Mary.
I don't understand it.
If I may, I'll have Mary Rice explain the impacts of what a walnut tree and what its roots can do to other trees in that location.
Hi, my name is Mary
expert,
Rice.
Right?
Well, I'm not a tree expert, but I am a landscape architect, okay. so I have a little knowledge there on trees. But anyone can Google black walnut trees and find out that there is, you know, lots of university extension websites or arboretum sites that will give you recommendations for the types of plants that can safely be planted by black walnuts. And the issue with black walnuts is that the roots produce a chemical called juglone, and there are certain plant species that cannot tolerate that chemical. They'll, over time, wilt and die. So obviously, that's the last thing that we want to do on this site. The site is filled. You know, I looked at this whole area. It's filled with mature seedlings to mature walnuts, which tells me it's a very active site for walnuts. They're very happy, and they're not going to go away anytime soon. If you cut down the walnuts, the chemical remains in the soil for years. So there's no guarantee that the plants would survive even without the trees. And so using those recommended plant lists, I chose the plant material that I thought was appropriate to the site for screening, for the cultural requirements here, the amount of water, the sun, exposure to winds, and then their appropriateness for effective screening, and their ability to be planted by the walnuts. I think, and then it's also just the scale and growth rate and availability in nurseries and general pricing. And I did adjust the plant list to take a recommendation from the NICE's list that they submitted. The others were not appropriate, mostly because they are not tolerant of black walnuts and or are not available in nurseries, or their scale wasn't appropriate to the site, but primarily because they're not tolerant of being planted near black walnut.
Thank you very much.
Excuse me, but how high is the average new tree gonna be that you're putting in?
All of these, right through the center, I don't know if you can see that.
I can see it from here.
They're hemlock, and they are, I think they're 14 to 16s, and I don't have the plan in front of me. Oh, here I am.
Okay.
Yeah, they're 14 to 16s, half of them, and the others are 16 to 18. They're very large trees. Mm. And then there's a row, another scattering of the arborvitae that the NICE had recommended, and those are going in at a 6 to 8 foot in the start. They're behind for the most part, filling in additional screening between. And then there's a numerous row of mixed shrubs, deciduous shrubs.
Okay.
Again, they're also all native. They will form thickets, you know, and they'll be in front of that screening. They're not really meant to be effective screens on the house. So that's this whole evergreen swath.
Okay. And most of that will be green all year round, right?
Yes, okay. Except for this row up in the front, which is on Stephen's side. And that's, you know.
Okay.
So that was my question. The screening is going to be there for the winter?
Yeah.
The screening is there for the winter. It's also, this entire evergreen section is surrounded by a deer fence, commercial grade deer fence that's meant to last at least 20-year life. It'll be invisible. It's a black vinyl and metal post. I've also called for that fence to be maintained year-round. And I've also called for the hemlock, which is our native evergreen and is the tree that, you know, we see on the Nice's property, that those be sprayed. It's typical for them to be sprayed with a horticultural oil, and we do that twice a year. Hemlocks are doing very well now. They are susceptible to a woolly adelgid disease, but it's been very well controlled, and there should be no issue as long as they're maintained.
Thank you.
How many years would you have to spray?
Oh, you do that indefinitely.
Indefinitely?
Yeah.
Thank you. Mr. Watson?
Yes, I have a couple of things. So I wanted to give you a slightly different perspective on the landscaping plan. So we prepared a couple of boards just to give you an idea. We took our landscaping plan, and this is off of Google Earth, right. And it's been tipped, purposely tipped, and what we did was then. All this cumbersome stuff. We tipped it to show you. I think it gives you a much better perspective of how the two buildings relate. This is Mr. Flavin's house.
Right.
This is the Nice's house. This is the screening that we've proposed.
Right.
And you,
but there are other trees along there too.
Well, these are the trees that we showed that I mentioned last week that we had colored in last month,
right.
that we had colored in. I specifically said I was showing you the canopy of the trees. That's these trees. This is exactly the plan that you've seen before. So it clearly demonstrates to you that the proposed screening is in the right location. We have a similar board, which it's already up here. Good. And this is another version, basically of the same thing, except it's a straight down view, more like the plan. Again, if you look closely, and I have copies that for the board, you can see the outline of the house. You can see the outline of the Mr. Flavin's house. Where the accessory apartment will be. That's the septic system. It's already in place. Incidentally, Mr. Richmond was incorrect. We're not proposing a curtain drain on the other side. We stated that there is a curtain drain that was put in. It's already there. It was put in to allow the installation of the septic system in there and drain the water from around the septic system. But there's no curtain drain being proposed at this point. We are proposing to exit the roof drains towards the northeast. Or northwest, excuse me, so that the roof drains will be directed away from the Nice's house. That I have small copies of that for the board.
One second. Can you see that the Vinnie and Paul have been mailed that for the next month's meeting? Thank you.
These, you may find these easier to follow, the small versions of these easier to follow just because of the distance. If you have a question regarding the site plan, I'd be happy to try to answer it.
Okay.
Okay. The third graphic needs a little bit of explanation. What we did is we took a contour that's above at the top of any of the changes. And we spaced out along that contour, we put a point every 20 feet from well north of the proposed construction to well south of the proposed construction on the Nisus property. And then we traced the path of the water. And it's a relatively easy thing. It goes from one contour, the shortest route to the next contour, the shortest route to the next contour. Water, we all know, goes downhill. It takes the least resistant way. And what you see here are a lot of green. And if you look at the legend, you see that green is the existing condition that won't change. As you might expect, where there's no activity proposed on the north of the property of the proposed garage, this is green all the way. In other words, these four green stripes don't change from before to after construction. And they all exit the Flavin property onto the Nice property well behind their house, as it has forever. You have a similar situation with these four green stripes that come down. Two wander back and forth, and they eventually come back to the same spot and leave the Flavin property at the same point. Now again, it's just water running downhill the easiest way. If you look in the middle, you'll see. I have to remind myself. You'll see. You'll see red lines. The red lines, where we start out with a green line, for instance, it changes to a red line, and it eventually matches a green line. The red lines indicate the flow of water today. With the construction, the water will flow somewhat differently. So what will happen is we come up to that same point where the green turns to a red and a blue, the water will then take the blue route to a point where it joins again. And you see the water at the north end gets pushed a little bit to the north, and then it comes around, goes a little bit to the south, and then it rejoins. In the south extreme, there's hardly any movement in the water. In the middle, the two do move on to the south, flow into the area where we will have the screening. And there's some design element in that. But eventually flows back, lines turn green again, where the flow pattern comes together and continues out and off the property. So what we're demonstrating to you here is that the flow today will change where we do the things, but by and large, before the construction and after the construction, it won't change at all. During construction, it will change. There will be some additional flow to the south towards that berm that we're going to construct to hold, I mean, that mounting that we're going to construct to construct the screening. But then it eventually rejoins and picks up basically the same route all the way down till it exits the property. So there's no redirection of the flows out of this property onto the Nisus property. It will be redirected back to its original course, and that's what will happen. I'd be happy to answer any questions on either of those.
All right. Do you have any questions, Lori? They're pretty sure.
I have one question.
Sure.
What I'll do is, bird is mounted at septic system. That's right where it is. Will all that water impede their septic?
The Flavin septic.
The Flavin? I don't know where the Flavin septic is.
No, my mom.
It's like where the two arrows converge.
See where the green, right there.
Here?
No, down. Right
down here?
Okay, back a little bit. No, down. Down. Now forward towards those, right there, all around there, and where those two green things are. It's huge. It's a huge septic field.
It's a field.
Whose fields are we talking about? I'm sorry. Yours? Oh, Mrs. Knight. Okay, well, I didn't know who we're talking about. So we're talking about your fields.
Correct.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Good.
All I can tell you is
this is the current water flow, though, right? The green is the current water flow.
The green is current and future. It will not change.
Okay.
So when it exits the property, it's going to exit the property in exactly the same place within a couple of feet, and eventually it basically comes out of the property at exactly the same place as it exits the property now. Okay. And it presumably has been exiting the property there for many years.
So I guess my question is, the flow to Mrs. Nice's septic fields will not change from what it is today?
Well, not from anything that we're contributing through this project. I just don't know enough about it to give you a logical answer or informed answer.
Thank you. Okay. Any questions from Mr. Nice's attorney, maybe? Or?
Well, just a couple things. I mean, it seems to be that the goal as the
Oh, yeah, I got to go up to the. Sure. Yeah, I'm sorry, I got to go up to the team.
Thank you.
Again, for the record, Dan Richmond with the firms Aaron and Steinmetz. I think it goes back to the points I was trying to make earlier. First, I think the Flavins, their counsel, and their consultants are making the point that the goal here is to sufficiently and effectively screen this project from the Nice property. So I think that can clearly be made a condition of any approval, that the goal is for this to be effectively screened. Again, that ties into what I was saying, the bonding requirement, which they don't appear to contest, is something your board clearly has the authority to do. To make a tie the bonding requirement to confirm that there should be effective screening, that whatever they need to do, whatever is required to do to ensure effective screening, your board, or you can have your building inspector and examine it within a year, and then ensure that whatever is put in there survives for three seasons. Again, I think there's a fairly standard application. Similarly, they seem very confident, representing that there's going to be no stormwater impact to our clients. I'm unclear, however, if there is going to be during construction stormwater, more stormwater flowing here towards a berm that is not yet constructed. Is that where you were? You said your goal is to put a berm here, right?
Well, there's fill to raise the level of the ground in order to provide place for the plants to give them more, make them more effective.
Correct.
But is that going to be put in? You said, but during construction, the result is going to be a crushing flow going this way, at least during construction.
Well, I'm sure that can be handled. I mean, you would put in erosion control there, and you standard construction requires the sediment and erosion control. We've provided for that.
Well,
would the building inspector check that?
I don't know what the building inspector does, but it's on our plans. It's certainly on the septic plan.
It's on the plan. Okay.
Well, again, I think that should be a specific condition.
Okay.
A couple of conditions related to any, action your board takes here is first to ensure that during construction, adequate soil erosion control plans are being, and that bonding is in place to ensure during construction, and I would say for at least 1 year to ensure that if there are any stormwater impacts that are unanticipated that do occur that adversely affect the Nice family, that there's action that can be taken to correct that situation.
All right, I think the easiest way to do this would be for you to send a letter to our attorney, okay, and what restrictions or what you're requesting to
be? They've already memorialized that their prior correspondence.
Okay, so yeah, you have.
I believe, correct?
I'm happy. I mean, I think I'm amplifying some of the things we said, but I think coming up with some perhaps additional requirements. If Mr. Rod, maybe it's easier if Mr. Rod wants to call me and we can go through it. I'm happy to.
No, I think things need to be in the record. If you feel that you need My understanding is the issue of the bonding and the concerns were raised in your correspondence.
Right.
They've already been raised, and you're amplifying it now on the record, and you're explaining the basis for that. Mm-hmm. My understanding is it's up to the board, but eventually you're going to be closing the meeting tonight.
Correct.
So I would, it's up to you if you want to, I would close the meeting right. if you deem fit, as opposed to submitting additional correspondence.
Right. My intention is to close the public hearing tonight. The other two...
Could I just, on that point, I mean, if the chair could close the public hearing and then allow for a written comment period for a brief period thereafter, sort of a typical provision. Again, I mean, this is something the chair suggested that might be helpful to the board, and you know, I can talk about my clients if they think it's worthwhile.
And if I may,
I understand. The next one will be what, the fifth public hearing, I believe.
We're not asking to extend.
No, I'm sorry, it's been the fifth public hearing, and I'm sure. I think you have to agree that we've given you ample time, and we've given everybody ample time to speak on this.
And I appreciate, in particular, the chair.
And everybody's putting a lot of diligence into this. Okay, so what I'm trying to say is I'm not going to carry it on forever.
But I didn't ask you. No, I was just the chair asked for us to make a written submission. I'm
right, and that was my mistake because it has already had been done.
Okay.
So, at this point in time, good questions? I'm sorry.
Yeah, we just got this tonight, correct?
Right. I think we've answered that.
These were just those comments that we submitted are furthering our comments before the board this evening. They are not
this
new
was
comments.
About the accessory
they were in
apartment.
Response to the accessory apartment, which we've addressed
we've
before
addressed
the board this
the
evening.
Accessory apartment. In my
but there is no.
Would it be fair to give them a chance to respond to this? Or?
Sure.
On the accessory apartment.
I haven't had an opportunity. I mean, that letter just produced today. That's what I said at the beginning.
That's what I'm saying.
If I may, Mr. Lim, not.
I think we're starting to.
Right, the comments regarding the accessory apartment.
Let's get a little bit into the weeds here. Okay, as far as the accessory apartment, in all honesty, I was in the house. There is no accessory apartment. I mean, I don't know how much more we have to go into that.
On my site visit, I looked in the kitchen windows. I didn't go inside the house, but it doesn't look like the accessory apartment to me. I just want to give him a fair shake of responding to this since we just got it tonight.
Sure.
After that, no more. No, I mean it. No more. Every night we can't be getting stuff, and then because I can't read this tonight. I don't have time at this meeting to read it.
Okay.
That's why I.
Again, we responded, Mr. Lim. We responded to their comments as of September 7th regarding an accessory apartment.
Does he have a right to respond back? And that's it.
They had provided comments regarding drainage.
So this is heavy to carry to the car.
And Mr. Chairman, again, the comments were regarding screening, and then we received this on September 7th saying accessory apartment.
I'd like to give you.
Go ahead.
Him a chance to respond to this and then close it.
Go ahead.
No more responding, no more anything.
I'll talk to my clients if we want to take that opportunity. I very much appreciate that.
Okay.
And if the board sees fit, we certainly would be happy to show the video. But if again, if there's no,
and
we provided those with our submissions as
well.
We can
show the video.
And just so I'm clear, I mean, if you feel that you have to submit materials that I don't want to foreclose you from your ability to submit something that you think has not been addressed or adequately addressed.
So maybe, again, that's what I was suggesting. If you wanted to do a 10-day written submission after you close the hearing tonight, again, I think I've seen that provision. It's fairly standard.
And again, we would request the board limit that to comments regarding the accessory apartment.
Well, I think Mr. Rudd was saying that there were some other, you know.
I think you kind of won the accessory apartment, you know, in all honesty. But, you know, if you want to.
would it be? It's going to be put over till next month.
Okay.
Would it be reasonable if you need 7 days from tonight to submit additional materials? You tell me.
That's reasonable. I appreciate that.
And the applicant, if they feel that new issues are raised, to respond to that 7 days after that.
We agree to that.
Okay.
Okay.
That's it, right?
That's it. All right. Do we need to see the video for the headlight thing?
I'd like to see it.
Okay. Mr. Watts, can we see that, please?
Let's see it.
And Mr. Flavin will review for the board, since he was the one that drove the vehicle down the driveway, what you're seeing.
Okay, he's
going to
be the
narrator.
He's the driver? Okay.
Driver and videographer. Yes.
And
While Mr. Watson is setting up the video, if I may respond just to the request for the bond. As we previously addressed to the board in response to their prior correspondence, the town has its ability through its building inspector to enforce conditions of the board. So a bond would certainly be something that's appropriate on a very large scale project. But as this board is aware, this is a very minor accessory apartment above a garage. So those type of requirements, again, we see fit with the board. But ultimately, what we're presenting here is that this is a code enforcement issue for that of the building inspector. And again, we are proposing the screening, and we understand that the screening can be a condition to the approval, but that a bond wouldn't be required. Consistent with the code enforcement abilities of the building inspector and the condition of the approval.
Okay.
Again, the building, I would just note, the building inspector may have a certain ability, but again, that's sort of a meaningless requirement if they have to go looking for enforcement. It's far easier. And again, it's this very standard requirement. I'm surprised we're getting any pushback from the applicant on this to require a bond if they're so confident the screening will exist. And particularly, they're raising new issues about the black walnut tree making planting even more difficult there. I'm surprised we're getting any pushback. It would seem to be in their interest, in everyone's interest, to ensure that there's effective screening between the properties, and that it three seasons seems is a reasonable period to ensure that it lasts. Thank you.
Okay. Well, both attorneys have, 7 days, is that what we said, to submit?
Well, 7 days for counsel on behalf of the Bice family, and then 7 days after that for any reply, if they deem necessary, by the applicant.
Okay.
It should go, yeah. I think that would be correct.
Do you see anything?
Basically, there are three sequences that were shot with different light levels. The one during the daylight, so you can see the layout of the property, okay, the path of the car.
And this is the existing driveway, and this is where you could this is where you can continue down around to the house to the.
Mm-hmm. This is my garage.
I'm sorry?
Those are all deciduous trees.
Mm-hmm. Right. Okay.
And the where this rock is where the that's the site for the building.
Where the rock is what? I'm sorry.
That rock was just passed on the right. Is the site for the building.
Where you're building, that's building site, okay.
Yeah.
And you're continuing now to where? To go around to the garage?
Yeah, it's following
the
contour
of the road.
That's on the site plan. Mm-hmm.
Beautiful day.
Yeah.
Nice and sunny.
just to point out, this area right in here is built up from rock that was, that came from blasting from our addition, and this would be lowered so that and some of the rock will be used in the building so the garage level will actually be lower than it is shown here.
Okay.
Can you show me the point where the headlights supposedly go through the woods into the
They have a different light level.
Okay.
So you're going back the same the way you come down now, right? Is that it?
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, just turning around.
For the written record, again, showing dense screening along the sides of the roads here, you see the existing trees that are located. There's some brush as well. But again, additional trees are being proposed. Additional trees are being proposed, which we'll show in the next video, where the headlights, if there would be, where the additional screening will be included to address that. That will be the evergreen trees.
Okay.
And this is the addition, actually, obviously. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Now, this is shot at twilight, and you can see where the headlights are. And these were shot with high beams as well, so. You can see the angle of the road points the lights down towards the Nice's lawn and into the brush, and obviously there'll be a tree screen there, so it may be difficult to see the license.
Right. Now you're going back to the same location, going around to where the garage door is going to be.
Same circuit, yeah.
Okay.
Just different light levels, same circuit.
Can you just do me one favor? Could you just run this again, this one here, and stop it to the point where it points towards a nice house?
Okay.
I'm trying to say.
The next one actually, it's darker.
Okay.
Yeah, the next one is at night.
Because I haven't seen a nice house yet, so I'm just trying to see.
You are challenging my technical expertise by asking me to stop this thing in the middle.
Well, no, that's okay. That's all right. Well, when it gets to that area, just give me an idea.
So at this point, you're pointing towards the nices, and now we're turning away.
Now this is going around your house down to where
following the same
where path. Where you're going, right, okay.
And you can see the lights of the nicest house. You can see where the headlights are pointing.
Okay.
So the driveway actually points?
It points more towards the Hudson. Yeah, down towards the Hudson.
No? No, the road runs north-south.
North-south, okay.
Yeah, more or less. But it's angled, it's angled downward, so the lights are pointing downward.
The direction of the road is, at this point, is clockwise.
Right.
Slightly clockwise.
So it goes around.
From a direction towards the nicest house, as you can see by the lights.
Correct.
Now here it gets a little more direct.
Okay. But that's all, those lights are pointing pretty much straight at the trees in front.
Mm-hmm. There's a
correct. Okay.
Those are incandescent lights. They're not reflection.
No, they're my lights.
They're your lights.
I have to ask. What is
One second. When it's finished, you can ask, please.
And again, the overall. Plane on this level will be lower, so that further lowers the headlights. Lowers the headlights. Vis-a-vis their house.
And again, just for the board's the board is aware of this. Again, this is an accessory apartment. The most that this driveway would likely be used is once or twice a day, if someone were to be using it to go in the morning or at night. So again, this is not a heavily used driveway. This is probably this going up and down the driveway is not the nature of this use. It is for an accessory driveway, for an accessory garage. So again, it's not to be used, frequently.
Okay. Yeah.
That's about it.
I saw it, yeah.
But
okay, one second. I'll finish this.
Okay?
Okay. That's good enough, I think. Anybody? Saw enough?
Yeah.
Enough? Yeah, I
saw it. Good. Okay, yes, sir. I'm sorry. Okay.
No,
if you want to speak.
It just takes one flash of light to create a seizure. So, regardless if it's passing, it just takes one set where there is pointing for Judge and Christianity. That's all I have to say.
Okay.
I just want to say for the record, I have no idea what that is supposed to prove. That the idea of the exercise is to show what the lighting impact is from, as seen from the Nice's house. It would have seemed easy enough for them to coordinate with the Nice's, as we've always tried to reach out to their council to work out issues. I don't see, again, I've asked the board, I think it would make sense to go there to see at night and do this at night, as we also wrote in our letter. Mrs. Nice actually saw this, so the point of this is to, I don't know, again, I don't really understand what that video is supposed to prove, because you could see the Nice house wearing their lights. Okay. So, and Mrs. Nice actually saw this experiment. So, again, I think to the extent that, if anything, it actually shows that there are going to be lighting impacts on the Nice family that need to be addressed for the duration, which obviously include bonding.
Let me ask you a question before I go to the decision. Have you been to the Nice's home?
My associate, Michael Cunningham, has.
Can I speak to him? Get up there, please.
For the record, Michael Cunningham, Zarin Simons.
Mr. Cunningham, you've been to Mr. Nice's home?
Correct.
Okay. Is there a long driveway going into Mr. Nice's home?
Yes.
Okay. Is it a common shared driveway? What I mean by that is there that driveway shared for two houses?
I believe so, yes.
Yes. And the house to the left of Mr. Nice's house is his daughter's home?
Correct.
Correct. If I'm driving down that driveway, my lights are going to shine on both houses. Would that be correct?
I believe so. I was only there once, and it was during the day. So
thank you very much. Thank you. Okay. Anything else?
At this time, Mr. Chairman, no. I believe the applicants have done, certainly met with the neighbors, including correspondence with the Nice's Council regarding the proposed screening trees. We have hired a landscape architect to install trees that will be good for the location to provide additional screening at that location. The purpose of the video, of course, was to show the board that there is existing vegetation and a buffer there to show the downhill nature of that location for the driveway. And again, to emphasize that this is a very limited accessory use. The driveway will not be used excessively. So certainly Mr. Flavin has done, has gone to all expense to make sure that there's no drainage impacts, there's no glare or lighting impacts, and has proposed additional screening to help mitigate any potential impacts from this minor accessory use. So at this time, we would respectfully request that if the chairman sees fit for the close of the public hearing on this particular project.
Okay. At this point in time, I think we've pretty much gone over everything. And you have an opportunity to present something else for the next meeting and all like that. Mrs. Nice, Mr. Nice, I think you've been given ample opportunity to speak your mind. I guess Mr. Flavin also, you pretty much had your opportunity. Okay, so the other two board members are more familiar with it. You know, they've been at all the meetings and all like that. And like I say, you will have the opportunity to any added things. But at this point in time, we're going to make a motion that we close the public hearing. Do I have a second?
I'll second.
All in favor? Aye. That's unanimous. The public hearing is closed. We'll meet next year in October. We're supposed to be the 13th, but I think the 10th is Columbus Day. So we'll make it October 17th. It'll be here, 7:30. Okay. And that time, members review anything that you guys have sent in, you know, any things like that. And a vote will be taken. Thank you. That's it. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
Get to it quickly so I can review it before the next meeting.
It's got 7 days.
Yeah, because I want to try to get everything before the next meeting.
All right. At this time, make a motion to adjourn.
Second.
All in favor? Aye. Oh, wait. I'm sorry. Who? What? I can't hear
it.
What'd you say?
The minutes.
Oh, I forgot the minutes. Oh, I'm sorry. You got to speak louder. I'm getting old. Okay, minutes. You know what? I'm gonna let the minutes go because they're not here. Okay, two people who were who spoke at these meetings, both are not here. So let's got to go to the next meeting. Okay, we'll approve the next meeting. Thank you.
Thank you very much.